Welcome viewers. In this program, we are going to talk about a very important quantitative tool for research. Friends, we do conduct a lot of research. Many a times, we emphasize the quantitative aspect of research, but then as we know that the qualitative aspect of research is equally important. And what is the current trend going on in academics is the use of mixed method. In mixed method, we give nearly equal importance to both quantitative as well as qualitative aspects of research. Friends, our ultimate objective is to conduct a high quality research, that kind of research which is having lot of impact, that kind of research which is useful for society and industry. So, in order to perform that research, we require the use of many quantitative techniques. In this program, we are going to focus on one particular technique which has assumed greater importance and significance in recent times, as maximum of the research work which are being carried out in the past 5 to 6 years invariably use this technique, which is named as factor analysis. This factor analysis technique is the topic of this program, and in this program we are basically going to talk about factor analysis, a brief introduction. We are going to discuss different types of factor analysis, particularly two types of factor analysis which is there. The third segment will be covering the various statistical techniques and terminology associated with factor analysis. And finally, then we are going to talk about what are the major steps in applying factor analysis. So, friends, these are the four aspects that we are going to cover in this particular program. First of all, let us talk about what is factor analysis. Factor analysis is a multivariate technique. In this particular analysis, the distinction between dependent and independent variable is not there. So, it is more of interdependence technique, where all the variables are interdependent on one another. Friends, as I say that this factor analysis, being a multivariate analysis, is actually a group of various statistical techniques which are performed with the purpose of data reduction and data summarization. What happens that we develop an instrument or questionnaire, and we use Likert scale, and we bring in large number of variables. Now, these variables need to be reduced, and then we try to club and combine some of the common variables to some particular dimension, which is also known as factor. And so, with large number of variables, we can reduce them to less number of factors. Now, we also can view this factor analysis as a statistical procedure for grouping variables into different subsets, which I have already said that these are called factors. Similarly, the variables with each set are mutually highly correlated. That is meaning thereby that if some variables are falling under one particular factor, then they are mutually highly correlated among themselves, whereas at the same time those variables which are in different subsets are relatively uncorrelated. And so, this is the degree of correlation with each other that determines that whether a particular set of variables will fall under a particular subset or dimension or factor. And so, moving further with our introduction, that the basic purpose of factor analysis is to describe the variation among many variables in terms of a few underlying but unobservable random variables called factors. And so, this pattern or these factors might not be quite visible or quite observable, but then the underlying current is there that is linking some of the variables to some particular factor. So, that is where you should be able to understand that all the covariance or correlations are explained by common factors. So, there are two types of factors that we are talking about. One is the common factor, which is the governed by all the covariance or correlations which are explained by this common factor. Now, those factors which that particular portion of the variance which remains unexplained by the common factor goes to the residual segment. Now, these residual error terms are called unique factors, and so this particular distinction should be very clear to you at the outset that there are two types of factors. One is the common factor and second is the unique factor. Moving further, then we have to also discuss that there are two different types of factor analysis which is possible. The first one is called exploratory factor analysis and the second one is called confirmatory factor analysis. One by one, we are going to discuss both of them. Now, first one is the exploratory factor analysis. It is used to discover the factor structure of a construct and examine its reliability. Now, we should understand that this exploratory factor analysis is basically data driven, and then the primary purpose of this exploratory factor analysis is to define the underlying structure among the variables in the analysis, that what kind of factors which are emerging from the data that is made available to us. On the other hand, we have the second type of factor analysis that is called confirmatory factor analysis. Now, in this confirmatory factor analysis, what happens is that it is used to confirm the fit of the hypothesized factor structure to the observed data, and this is basically driven by theory. And so, here we are trying to confirm that theoretically what factors we are able to shortlist and identify, that whether this fit is there or not between the two. So, both are having important role, but then as a researcher we should conduct exploratory factor analysis first, followed by the confirmatory factor analysis. Now, we turn our attention to the factor analysis model. Now, in this particular slide that you are seeing that the unique factors are uncorrelated with each other and with the common factors. Now, this is here the individual common factor can be expressed as the linear combination of observed variables in such a manner that we have this mathematical equation which says that Fi, where Fi stands for estimate of ith factor, and this is equal to Wi1, this is the weight or factor score coefficient for the first variable, then multiplied by x1, this is the first variable, and so on, then Wi2 x2 plus Wi3 x3 plus and so on Wik xk, and so there are a total of k variables which are there in the problem. And so, once again we have Fi as the ith factor, we have Wi as the weight or factor score coefficient, and we have the x as the variable, and there are k number of variables, and so this range is from x1 to xk. This particular factor analysis model helps us in understanding that what kind of factors that can emerge from the study. It is possible to select weights or factor score coefficients so that the first factor explains the largest portion of the total variance. Now, first factor is identified, then we move to the second set of weights that can be selected, and now the second factor accounts for the residual variables, those variables which are assigned to the first factor are excluded, and then the residual variance is considered subject to being uncorrelated with the first factor. As I said, that those were left out by the first factor and they are considered for the second factor because they happen to be having close proximity to the second factor. In this manner, we proceed from first factor to second factor to additional factors, and then a series of finite number of factors which are identified. Then still towards the end, we find that there are still some residual variables still there which could not be assigned to any of the factors. And as I have already explained to you earlier, that the two types of factors which are there, that is, one is the common factor and second is the factor which is known as the unique factor. Now, so far we have been talking about three aspects we discussed. First one is the factor analysis, a brief introduction. Second one, we talked about two different types of factor analysis which is possible. And the third one, we discussed a brief description of the factor analysis model. Now, we turn our attention to the different terminology or statistical techniques that we use in the context of factor analysis. One by one, we talk about them. The first one is called the Bartlett's test of sphericity. Now, as far as the Bartlett's test of sphericity is concerned, we develop a null hypothesis, and that null hypothesis states that the variables are uncorrelated in the population. And what we actually are trying to test is that this particular null hypothesis gets rejected, and then statistically significant Bartlett's test of sphericity emerges in such a manner that our hypothesis, researcher's hypothesis, would be that the population correlation matrix is an identity matrix where each variable perfectly correlates with itself, and that variable is perfectly is not at all correlated with any other variable, in such a manner that an identity matrix is emerging where 1 1 1 is there in the primary diagonal, and both in the upper and lower triangle we get 0 0 0 values in the remaining of the matrix. So, a perfect identity matrix is emerging. But then, as we know very well, that this could not be possible. The Bartlett's test values can vary between 0 to 1. Now, less than 0.5 would not be considered. Above 0.5, between 0.5 to 0.7 is acceptable, but again above average, greater than 0.7 and going up to 1.0 would be considered to be very high. And so, a statistically significant Bartlett's test of sphericity indicates that sufficient correlation exists among the variables to proceed further. And so, this Bartlett's test of sphericity is conducted as a kind of a litmus test that whether can we proceed further with this particular factor analysis or not. If we find a value below 0.5, then the suggestion or recommendation is that we should not try to attempt the factor analysis model. The reason is that the correlation among the variable is not high enough to be clubbing them or classifying them under any finite set of factors. Now, moving further, then we discuss the second aspect, that is called the communality. Now, communality is basically the amount of variance a variable shares with all the other variables being considered. This is measured in terms of the proportion of variance explained by the common factors. Now, this communality score is very important for our context of factor analysis. Then the eigenvalues, which represent the total variance explained by each factor. And here also the threshold is there that the eigenvalues must be greater than 1. And then we talk about the factor loadings. Now, these factor loadings are simple correlation between the variables and the factors. This factor loading can be also plotted, and so a factor loading plot emerges. That factor loading plot is a plot of the original values using the factor loadings as coordinates. But then what we are particularly interested is the KMO test. KMO test is known as the Kaiser-Meyer-Olkin. Now, this is a test for measure of sampling adequacy, in the sense that whether our sample is adequate to go ahead with the factor analysis test. This KMO, measure of sampling adequacy, is basically used to examine the appropriateness of factor analysis. High value between 0.5 and 1 indicates that factor analysis is appropriate to be used in those situations, and a value of less than 0.5 suggests that the factor analysis should not be conducted at all. Similarly, we try to develop iscri plot. Now, this iscri plot is basically a plot of the eigenvalues against the number of factors, where we put the number of factors on the x axis and the eigenvalues we put on the y axis. Now, these statistical terminology and statistical tests that we were talking about, more significant among them are the three things, that is, one is the Bartlett's test of sphericity, second is the KMO test. These two are used in conjunction to decide that whether to proceed with factor analysis or not, and then the eigenvalues, which are plotted in the form of iscri plot, to decide that how many number of factors that will be taken up as the common factors, and the remaining factors that which will be left as the residual and will be termed as the unique factors. Proceeding further, then we talk about the fourth and final segment, that is the different steps that are taken in application of factor analysis. The first step covers data calculation and preparation of the relevant covariance matrix. In the second step, the extraction of the initial factors take place. Third step, rotation to a terminal solution is done. This rotation is very important, and we will talk about it. And fourth step will be making final decision. At the first stage, we talk about the data collection and preparation of the relevant covariance matrix. This involves collecting information on a set of entities or objects for the variable of interest. This basic data must be arranged in a systematic way, which is called data matrix. Now, this correlation matrix is generated for all types of variables. Further, those variables which are not related to others are identified. We have to think in terms of correlation as an absolute value. And as we have been talking about, that once we have come to this stage, then these two tests, Bartlett's test of sphericity and KMO test, will be conducted at this stage. Second step involves the extraction of the initial factors. Now, this particular step is an important one, which involves finding the number of factors that can effectively explain the observed correlations or covariances among the observed variables. Now, this is achieved through, this is done through a method which is called principal components analysis. In short, it is called PCA method. Now, that is where we try to see the total variance in the data is measured. Now, this step also helps in determining the minimum number of factors that will account for maximum variance in the given data. And so, that is the process that we follow in factor analysis, that the first factor that we are selecting should cover the maximum number of variables, and higher variance is explained by that factor, and going on to the second factor, which is hierarchically low and will have the less loadings as compared to the first factor, and so on like that. And so, this extraction is done at that particular point of time, and in this regard, the two statistical criteria which are useful, one is the eigenvalues, and which is the determination of the number of factors, is generally done by considering only those factors where the eigenvalues are greater than 1. And second, as I have already explained earlier, is the iscri plot. This iscri plot is an analysis that shows how many factors or components you have to retain in your analysis of factor or principal component analysis. This is a graphical representation. The graph looks like this, where you find that on the x axis the factor numbers are given and on the y axis the eigenvalues are given, and this graph is sharply decreasing, and then at one particular point of time the threshold limit where it smoothens and flattens off. And so that explains that above that eigenvalue of 1 where the sharp decline is there, those factors are chosen and remaining ones are treated as the unique factor. Now, as I said that without rotation this whole analysis will not make any meaning, and so this rotation is required, and so that we can our whole factor analysis becomes easier to interpret. And we should have actually possibilities of two types of rotation is there. One is called orthogonal rotation and second is called oblique rotation. Commonly, normally we resort to orthogonal rotation many of the times, and particularly under orthogonal rotation we choose the Verimax method of rotation, and that is where we have now come to the fourth and final stage step of our application of factor analysis, which is called making the final decision. Now, final decision is about the number of factors to choose, and also this is based on the rotation that is done, and this can be easily interpreted also. Now, this decision is taken on the basis of three criteria. First criteria is a priori conceptual beliefs and conceptual foundations, that number of factors which are emerging from past research or theory. Then eigenvalues which are computed in the step 2, and the relative interpretability of the rotated solution in step 3. Based on these three criteria, we make final decision about the factors to be retained as the common factors. Friends, in this particular program, we have been talking about factor analysis, an introduction, different types of factor analysis, different statistical techniques which are part of factor analysis, and in the last segment, we have been talking about the overall step by step procedure for application of factor analysis. Thank you.